G'day, Year 9. Welcome back to learning this term. We're going to kick this term off with a new topic straight away. The topic that we're going to talk about is about exploring right-angled triangles and growing on from some of that work that we've seen previously with Pythagoras' theorem. So what a better place to start than back at Pythagoras' theorem. So just remember, Pythagoras was this old Greek guy who had a bunch of mathematicians around him, and what they discovered was there was relationships about all the sides within a right-angled triangle. So to start off with our right-angled triangle, it's important to be able to identify a couple of key features straight away. And the first key feature to identify is, what is our hypotenuse? Now, our hypotenuse, traditionally people go, it's just the longest side in a triangle. And in a right-angled triangle, the hypotenuse is always the longest side, but we're going to give the hypotenuse a very special definition. So, that's very bright. Let's go slightly darker. That, yes, the hypotenuse is the longest side in a right angle triangle, but that's because it is opposite the right angle. So the hypotenuse in a right angle triangle, hypotenuse only exists in a right angle triangle because a hypotenuse is the side that is opposite or on the other side of a triangle to the right angle. And so you can see that down the bottom left here, we've got our right angle, and the hypotenuse, it's on the other side of the triangle. So that longest side of our triangle, we're going to name the hypotenuse. Now, when it comes to Pythagoras' theorem, the shorter sides, we're just going to call A and B for the moment, and the hypotenuse, I'm going to give it the algebraic term C. So remembering that we've got a right angle triangle and we've labeled our sides A, B, and C, C being a hypotenuse, A and B the shorter sides. Now, something fun about Pythagoras' theorem, hopefully remember that the C squared was equal to A squared plus B squared. Just here on the left, you can see that when we extend the area of this triangle out, it breaks apart and is able to be formed into those other two triangles. So what you can see here is, as we are rotating this round, the larger square, the liquid from the larger square, it's rolling around and it's adding up and filling up those two lower squares until it gets to the point where it completely fills up both squares. So scrolling on down, these notes, when you see, you can click on that link and watch that video again yourself. So let's go into some notes here again, just quickly recapping what's going on. So C squared equals A squared plus B squared, where C is the hypotenuse. And remember, it's the side that is opposite the right angle, and A and B are the what we call the shorter sides, because the right angle is the largest angle and whatever's opposite is always going to be the largest side. So A and B, because they're not opposite the right angle, they are the shorter sides straight away. So let's look at some examples quickly. So in these examples here, I want you to find the value of the pronumeral in the following, and we're required round to one decimal place. So if we just zoom in here and have a look at question A here. So before we go anywhere, let's identify what's going on. We go across here, there's our hypotenuse, right? And conveniently it's been labeled C, and 7 and 24, they're our shorter sides. So before we go anywhere, we know that C squared is equal to A squared plus B squared. So that's our Pythagoras theorem. So let's substitute into that from our triangle, and our hypotenuse is C squared. Our shorter side is 7 squared, and our other shorter side is B squared. So what we're going to do now, let's just evaluate what 7 squared plus 24 squared is. So on our calculators, 7 squared plus 24 squared, and that equals 625. So we know that C squared is equal to 625. Now, this isn't the final step, because if something's only 7 meters tall and 24 meters wide, it doesn't seem reasonable that there's 625 meters distance between those two points. So the actual answer to C is whatever the square root of 625 is, because up in this line here we have C squared, and here we just want C. So back over our calculator, we're going to find this square root of 625, and looking at our answer, that gave us a nice number straight away. And don't forget to include our units when we solve our question there. Right, example B here, we've seen our triangles twisted slightly, but again, the same principles apply. So before we're going to attack anything here, let's identify all our bits of information. So opposite the right angle, there's 16, so that's our hypotenuse, which means 6 and x, they're going to be our shorter sides. So we can label that C if we wanted to, A and B. So here, again, Pythagoras' theorem says that C squared is equal to A squared plus B squared. So 16 squared is equal to X squared, because that's what we labeled as A, plus 6 squared. Now let's use our calculator and evaluate. So 16 squared is equal to 256. 256 is equal to x squared, and 6 squared, that's just 36. Now, when we get to this line, hopefully you've noticed that this line here, it's slightly different from what we've had previously. If we look at the past example, we had this line of working here straight away, where we had all of the algebra on one side and all of the numbers on the other side. Unfortunately, in this case here, we don't have that. What we want to do is we want to get this 36, and we want to bring it over and associate it with the 256. When we take it across an equal sign, we've got to do the opposite to it. So currently it is plus 36. So we need to do the opposite of that, which is we're going to take 36 away. So if I'm going to take 36 away from this side, I need to take 36 away from the other side. And 256 take away 36, well, that's 220 is equal to x squared. Now we're kind of at the exact same point that we were previously. Up here we had c squared equals 625. Now we have x squared equals 220, all right? Very important to understand when we need to take something away, and when we are finding a shorter side, we're always going to have this extra step of taking away. So back to our calculator, the square root of 220 is equal to, so I'm just going to write this differently, x squared equals the square root of 220. So x is equal to 14.83 blah, 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 which, moving that up there, x is equal to 14.8 millimeters. Sorry, move that too far up. 14.8 millimeters when I round it to one decimal place. All right, so don't forget, when we're finding the hypotenuse, we're actually finding the longer side or the hypotenuse, we're adding, and we can go straight to our square root. When we've got to find the shorter side, there's going to be a point where we've got to take away before we can do our square root. All right, one more example to quickly go through before I let you off go and get some work done. So here this question says, what is the, and it's got this word, exact value of x in the following diagram. Okay, so it's interesting that it's got this word exact value, and we're going to come back It's a way of saying, you know, previously I asked you to round to one decimal place. This doesn't say rounding. I want to know the exact answer. So again, let's start off and go, there's our hypotenuse. All right, so, and we're going to call it C, and there are our shorter sides, A and B. All right, so what we're going to do here, we're going to say, well, C squared is equal to, actually, I'm going to write this differently right now, because I can, A squared plus B squared equals C squared, and I'm going to say that X squared plus 8 squared equals 12 squared. I'm going to evaluate what 8 and 12 are. So x squared plus 8 squared, which is 64, and 12 squared is 144. All right, same as the previous step. What we need to do now is then we need to take away 64 from both sides. And what we get left with is x squared equals 144 minus 64, which equals 80. So our next part is x is got to equal the square root of 80. So let's do that on our calculator. The square root of 80 is equal to, and hopefully you notice up here on our calculator, we've got a lot of decimals, all right? So that's not great, all right? Coming back, the question says, what is the exact value, all right? The exact value isn't writing down all these decimals. Our calculator, it's only limited. It can only show us so many numbers. The screen's only so big. This number here, it may have a lot more decimals after this value one. It could all of a sudden stop after that value one. We don't know. So when we're going to write an exact answer, we want to use every single decimal that there's possibly there. And we have a little trick in mathematics, and the way that we do that is we just leave our answer exactly like this. We just leave it underneath the square root symbol. All right, what was our units? It was no units. So we're gonna leave it exactly underneath our square root symbol. And when we leave it exactly under our square root symbol, we give it a special name. When we leave things under square root symbols, we call them surds. And they're a way of saying, well, I want to use every single decimal that's included when I find the square root of 80. And instead of writing it all out and writing ugly decimals, we just leave it nice and simply as the square root of 80. So when I ask you to find, you know, an exact value and there's lots of decimals, leave it underneath the square root symbol. All right. Hopefully that's explained very quickly. Some examples on Pythagoras' theorem. If you need to, go back, rewatch the video, hit up your teachers if you've got any extra questions. The work that you need to get done for this lesson, if you go to the Cambridge textbook, there's two parts I need you to get done. From exercise 4B, I want you to do all of question 1, question 4, C and F, question 5, C and F, question 6, C and F. After you've done that, go to exercise 4C, question 3, do all of question 3, question 4, C and F, question 5, C and F. Then we want you need to do is correct your work from the solutions from the Cambridge textbook. If you have made any mistakes, rewrite your working so that you've done it correctly. Take a photo of your completed work, making sure that it's all marked, and submit it via Canvas on the assignment box. And that is due by Friday, 16th of July at 3 o'clock. All right, U9, good luck with that. Catch you later.